Hey there, my name is Dr. Ankit Shah and I'm a practicing radiologist at Villeparle West and I practice at Eclat Polyclinic. I also happen to be the General Secretary of Musculoskeletal Ultrasound Society. Today I will be demonstrating the ultrasound scanning technique of the shoulder joint. From the anterior aspect, we will be evaluating the long head of the biceps, the subscapularis tendon and the acromioclavicular joint. Now we identify the long head of the biceps on the transverse view by placing our probe along the anterior shaft of the humerus, and as we scan upwards, we see the bicipital groove which is formed medially by the lesser tuberosity and laterally by the greater tuberosity. The long head of the biceps is seen as an echogenic oval structure which is prone to anisotropy. So as I rock my probe anterior and posteriorly, you see that the appearance of the long head of the biceps changes. So once I've scanned the long head of the biceps, I go all the way from the rotator interval superiorly till all the way down, till I keep on scanning down till I see the pectoralis major tendon coming into view, and that's where I stop. So on the short axis, what we see is the biceps tendon is flush with the bicipital groove and it is located within the groove itself. It is neither dislocated nor subluxed. And what we would like to look for is a possibility of a hypoechoic halo, which would represent effusion within the biceps tendon sheath. Once we've seen the biceps tendon on the short axis, what I do is I carefully turn my probe 90 degrees or perpendicular to the perpendicular to what my previous position, and I align myself with the long axis of the biceps tendon. So once I've seen, what I do is I scan upwards, I go all the way down, I go all the way down, I look at the long head of the biceps, go all the way down, and this is the muscular tendinous junction of the biceps tendon that we see over here. Now that we've evaluated the long head of the biceps, what we do is we ask the patient to externally rotate his arm and as much as possible. So what this maneuver does is it brings out the subscapularis tendon. So what I do is from the bicipital groove, I slide medially and I identify my bony landmark, which is the coracoid process that I see over here. Now in this view, what we see is we see that the coracoid process is medially, and as I slide my probe laterally, what I see is this is a subscapularis tendon which is forming and it goes all the way and it attaches over the lesser tuberosity. Once again, I slide medially, I go all the way, I identify the muscular tendinous junction of the subscapularis tendon in the long axis, and this is a coracoid process that I see. So while we're scanning the long head of the while we're scanning the subscapularis tendon in the long axis, what we do is it's important to know that it is a broad and flat tendon. So make sure that you make these micro movements and scan the tendon from superiorly to inferiorly and the other way around. So what I'm doing over here is I'm scanning the tendon along its long axis from superior to inferior over here. And we make sure that, you know, we scan the entire length and breadth of the tendon. Once I've scanned the tendon on the long axis, what I do is I turn my probe 90 degrees from what it was initially. And this is what the subscapularis tendon looks like. It typically has a multipennate appearance that we see. It's alternate areas of echogenic and hypoechoic bands that we see. So this is the superior edge and this is the inferior edge of the tendon. While I'm identifying the subscapularis tendon, what I do is I scan the entire tendon from its cranial edge over here that I see, till all the way down till its inferior edge, which makes sure that I have scanned the entire length and breadth of the tendon. Once again, let me repeat, it has a multipennate appearance with alternating areas of echogenic and hypoechoic bands, so do not mistake it for tendinosis or an interstitial tear. Make sure you have sweeping movements which go all the way from medial to lateral and superior to inferior. So this way we have scanned the entire subscapularis tendon in the short axis as well. So from the anterior aspect, one more structure that you can easily see is a coracoacromial ligament. After you scan the subscapularis tendon, Once again, you come to your bony landmark, which is your coracoid process, and you angle your probe gently towards the acromion. So what you see over here is this nice thick band-like structure that we see over here, that is your coracoacromial ligament. Okay, so you scan medial to lateral, and this is an entire thing is a coracoacromial ligament, which is really seen as an echogenic linear structure over here. Third structure that we see from the anterior aspect is your acromioclavicular joint. So the acromioclavicular joint is seen either by the palpation, or what you can do is you can place your probe over the bicipital groove over here, and you go all the way up, you go scanning all the way up, all the way up, all the way up, all the way up, and you come to the acromioclavicular joint over here. So laterally what you have is the acromion, and medially what you have is the clavicle. Alternatively, what you can do is you can identify the acromioclavicular joint by palpating the acromioclavicular joint along the superior aspect of the shoulder, or what you can do is directly drop your probe over the most prominent bony protuberance along the superior aspect of the shoulder, and what you see over here is the acromioclavicular joint. Once you've identified the joint, once again, this is the cortex of the acromion along the lateral aspect. Medially, you have the medial edge of the clavicle. And between the two bones, what you see is the acromioclavicular joint. This echogenic structure that we see over here, that's the fibrocartilaginous disc. The superior edge of the acromioclavicular joint is formed by a capsular ligament, which is your superior acromioclavicular ligament. So we scan the AC joint from anterior to posterior in smooth sweeping movements and look for any cortical irregularities which might be over there. So now we're going to examine the shoulder from the lateral aspect. Over here, what we're going to do is we're going to evaluate the supraspinatus tendon, the infraspinatus tendon, and the rotator interval along with the subacromial subdeltoid bursa. So what we do is we ask the patient to flex his elbow, okay, and extend his shoulder. So take it all the way back and ask him to touch his right lower back or the right gluteal region, or ask the patient to reach for the back pocket. And while we're doing this, make sure that the elbow is tucked in or as close to the spine as possible. This is typically known as the modified cross position, so that when the patient does this maneuver, what happens is the entire supraspinatus tendon comes out below the acromial edge, and we can assess the entire supraspinatus as well as the infraspinatus tendons. Once the patient is in the modified cross position, what I do is I place my probe along the long axis of the supraspinatus tendon. So what I see is the rotator cuff is seen as a beak shaped appearance, bird's beak appearance that we see over here. So as a beginner, it's always a good idea to count all the layers from the top. So on top, you have the most echogenic layer, which is your skin and the subcutaneous tissue, followed by you have the deltoid muscle, you have the subacromial subdeltoid bursa below the muscle, and this is seen as a thin echogenic line. It's a potential space, so it will be collapsed, and because of the peribursal fat, it is seen as an echogenic line. And below the subacromial subdeltoid bursa is your echogenic supraspinatus tendon, which has a fibrillary pattern. Below that, you have the hypoechoic articular cartilage, and just below that, you have the echogenic cortex of the humeral head. The supraspinatus tendon is seen as an echogenic beak-like structure, as I had said. So how do I make sure that my tendon fibers are seen absolutely parallel without any anisotropy? What I do is you take a look at the fibers of the deltoid muscle belly superiorly. So if you see these echogenic lines which are parallel, that means your probe is parallel to the supraspinatus muscle fibers. Or alternatively, you come anteriorly, you identify the long head of the biceps and try and scan in the long axis in that plane. So what we do is we scan the tendon from anterior to posterior. This is the cuff. As we go posteriorly, we see that the supraspinatus ends and infraspinatus tendon that we see. Again, I come anteriorly, and this is how we scan the entire cuff and the long axis. Often at times it is difficult to identify on the long axis which is the supraspinatus tendon and from where does the infraspinatus begin. So what we do is we can have a look at the greater tuberosity. Okay, so look at the morphology of the greater tuberosity anteriorly. Anteriorly, it's a little bit more sharp, and as we go posteriorly, the morphology of the greater tuberosity changes and it becomes more rounded. So when the greater tuberosity appears a little bit more rounded, you're more likely to be in the space of the infraspinatus, and as you come anteriorly, it's more likely to be supraspinatus due to the sharp edge of the greater tuberosity. One more thing to note is as this supraspinatus tendon fibers reach the greater tuberosity, what you see is that there's this little bit of anisotropy which is happening, and the tendon may appear hypoechoic. This is because there's curving of the fibers. Alright, so one way to reduce that anisotropy is you go a little bit laterally and you angle the probe and reduce the anisotropy as much as possible. So what we see over here is we've reduced the anisotropy and we've kept the tendon appears echogenic with this normal fibrillary pattern all the way till the greater tuberosity. Now as the tendon approaches the greater tuberosity, along the footprint you see a small hypoechoic area, and this is a fibrocartilage because this is where the tendon attaches over the greater tuberosity. So once we've identified the rotator cuff tendon in the long axis, what we do is I turn my probe 90 degrees gradually, very carefully I turn my probe 90 degrees and I evaluate the rotator cuff in the short axis. So this is what the cuff looks like. So this is anteriorly what I see is a biceps, and posteriorly what I see is a supraspinatus. A little bit more anteriorly I see the cephalate fibers of the subscapularis tendon. So as I go a little bit more posteriorly, once again, that's the subscapularis tendon, that's the biceps tendon at the rotator interval. This is the supraspinatus tendon, all right, and this is the infraspinatus tendon coming in. Now, how do I differentiate between the supraspinatus and infraspinatus on the short axis? It's a little bit simpler than doing it on the long axis. So as I go laterally, you see the humerus gets divided into at least two facets over here. The facets of the greater tuberosity have typically a configuration wherein anteriorly you have the more flattened facet, which is where your supraspinatus tendon attaches. A little bit more posteriorly, you have an oblique orientation of the facet where your infraspinatus tendon attaches. And as you go a little bit more posteriorly, you have a vertical facet where your teres minor tendon attaches. Okay, so this is how the tendons attach over the greater tuberosity. And as we go anteriorly, as we scan anteriorly, all right, just anterior to the supraspinatus tendon, what we have is a rotator interval. The rotator interval is formed between the supraspinatus tendon superiorly, the subscapularis tendon inferiorly, and the floor of the rotator interval is formed by the head of the humerus. Now looking at the rotator interval, it consists of three structures, which is the coracohumeral ligament, the biceps tendon, and the superior glenohumeral ligament. It's important to know the contents of the rotator interval and its clinical significance is that it is one of the dynamic stabilizers of the shoulder joint, and it is commonly involved during adhesive capsulitis or frozen shoulder. So what you see over here is at the rotator interval is the biceps tendon is kind of enveloped by a C-shaped structure that we see over here, and this C-shaped or the inverted C-shaped structure is formed by superiorly by the coracohumeral ligament and inferiorly by the superior glenohumeral ligament, and this entire structure what we see over here, that is known as a biceps pulley. So from the posterior aspect, what we'll be covering is the supraspinatus muscle belly, the infraspinatus muscle belly, the teres minor muscle belly and the tendon, as well as the posterior joint recess. Apart from that, we'll also be looking at the suprascapular nerve at the level of the suprascapular notch and the spinoglenoid notch. So for that, the most important bony landmarks that we need to remember is, one thing is the scapular spine. If it's a bony or if it's a thin individual, what you can do is you will be able to palpate the scapular spine, because it's important, because it divides the rotator cuff muscle bellies into the supraspinous fossa and the infraspinous fossa. And so your supraspinatus muscle belly arises from the supraspinatus fossa, infraspinatus muscle belly arises from the infraspinous fossa. So that's a good way of remembering. So what I do is I begin scanning the posterior shoulder by placing my probe along over the spinous process. And what I see is, inferior to the spinous process, I have the infraspinatus muscle belly, whereas superior to the spinous process, what I see is the supraspinatus muscle belly. Okay, so once again, supraspinatus, this is a infraspinatus, and as I go a little bit more below, I see is a teres minor muscle belly over here. The lateral part is not well visualized because of the shadowing of the acromion. And now what I do is I gradually turn my probe 90 degrees and evaluate the muscle belly in the long axis as well. So this is how the muscle belly looks like. You see the nice musculotendinous junction, and as I go laterally, like I said, because of the shadowing of the acromial and the coracoacromial arch, you don't see the entire supraspinatus tendon. Once I've evaluated the supraspinatus muscle belly, what I do is once again I come back to the scapular spine, and as I go inferior to the scapular spine, what I see is this is the infraspinatus muscle belly. As I screen in the short axis from medial to lateral, as I'm coming laterally, I see the infraspinatus muscle forming into a tendon, and it forms the proper tendon of the infraspinatus. After I've identified the infraspinatus muscle belly on the short axis, I turn my probe 90 degrees, I evaluate the infraspinatus muscle belly, go all the way laterally, all the scan laterally, and this is what the infraspinatus tendon which forms. It crosses the glenohumeral joint and it goes and inserts over the greater tuberosity over here. Below the infraspinatus, what you have is a teres minor muscle belly, which starts along closer to the lateral aspect of the scapula. Now, as a beginner it might be difficult to identify or differentiate between the supraspinatus and the teres minor muscle bellies. So what you can do is you can scan from medial to lateral, and as you go laterally you see that both the tendons are forming. Okay, so that's the infraspinatus tendon on top, and this is a teres minor tendon which is forming over here, and it attaches over the lesser tuberosity. So that's the infraspinatus tendon, and that's the teres minor tendon. So as I go scanning medially, I see that they're forming into a muscle. So as a practical point, it's much more easier to identify the infraspinatus and teres minor muscle bellies on the short axis along the lateral, as far lateral as possible. So we identify the glenohumeral joint either by scanning through the infraspinatus muscle belly, or what we do is we identify the inferior axillary fold, and what we do is I put my probe on that, and as I go up, I go scanning up, and I identify two bony landmarks. So medially, my bony landmark is a glenoid, which I see over here, and laterally, what I see over here, that's the humeral head, the echogenic humeral head, which is covered by the hypoechoic cartilage. So between the humeral head and the echogenic glenoid, what we see is a triangular structure which has an echogenicity which is slightly less than that of the cortex, and this is the glenoid labrum that we see. And just above the labrum, there's a muscle that we're seeing over here, and this is your infraspinatus muscle that we see over here. Okay, so when we're looking at the glenohumeral joint, what we do is we scan the entire joint recess from superior to inferior and as we go up. So if at all you have to inject within the glenohumeral joint, your needle would come from lateral angle towards the glenohumeral joint and between the glenoid and the humerus. The posterior joint recess is a great way to demonstrate glenohumeral joint effusion. So what you do is you ask the patient to gently internally and externally rotate the humerus or his arm, and what we see over here is if at all if there's any joint effusion, it will pop up through the posterior joint recess. So what we're seeing over here is we're seeing a humeral head which is rotating internally and externally. This is a glenoid, and that triangular structure that we see just lateral to the glenoid, that's your glenoid, posterior superior glenoid labrum. So from the posterior aspect, now what we're going to do is we're going to evaluate, or we're going to try and trace the path of the suprascapular nerve. We, in the standard shoulder examination, we evaluate the suprascapular nerve, which starts from the brachial plexus, courses along the posterior triangle, and then it enters the shoulder girdle via the suprascapular notch. It travels through the supraspinous fossa, gives a branch to the supraspinatus, and it winds around the spinoglenoid notch and gives a branch to the infraspinatus. So we evaluate the suprascapular nerve at the level of the suprascapular notch and at the level of the spinoglenoid notch. One way to identify the suprascapular notch along the superior border of the spinus, you identify the spine of the scapula, and what we do is we gradually walk your probe anteriorly, and you look at the notch over the scapular spine. So what we see over here is that there's a notch that we see over here, and there's a defect in the superior cortex of the scapular spine, and this is your suprascapular notch. If you're unable to see the nerve, at least what you can see is there will be a certain structure that you see pulsating over here. That's the suprascapular artery, and the suprascapular nerve is right next to the suprascapular artery that we see. You may or may not be able to see the signal on color Doppler, but that's not a problem. What you can do is you can just, even on your grayscale, you'll be able to see the pulsations of the artery. So we evaluate the spinoglenoid notch below the level of the suprascapular notch, and that's where we see the suprascapular nerve after it has given a branch to the supraspinatus. So what you do is you evaluate, you identify the glenohumeral joint and gently slide your probe medially. And right below the infraspinatus muscle belly, you see this valley-like structure, and that is your spinoglenoid notch. So laterally you have the glenoid, medially you have the spinous process, and nestled between them, that's your suprascapular nerve. If you are unable to identify the suprascapular nerve, just look for the pulsating suprascapular artery, and your nerve will be right next to that. So sometimes what happens is if there is a small tear in the posterior superior labrum, you might have a paralabral cyst forming which courses medially and which ultimately comes to the spinoglenoid notch, and it will compress the nerve, resulting in infraspinous atrophy. To look for subacromial impingement, we do dynamic evaluation with the patient standing. We place a probe along the lateral aspect of the acromion and ask the patient to abduct the arm and take it down. Again, abduct the arm, take it down. So what we do is we look for sliding of the supraspinatus below the lateral edge of the acromion, and look for sliding of the bursa as well. So what I'm seeing over here is that there's smooth sliding of the greater tuberosity as well as the supraspinatus tendon below the acromial edge. We evaluate acromioclavicular joint in dynamic imaging by asking the patient to touch his opposite shoulder repeatedly and extending the shoulder, okay, with his elbow flex. So this is what is known as the scarf test. So what we look for is if there's widening of the acromioclavicular joint space, or if there's abnormal movement between the acromion and the clavicle that we see over here. So if we see over here, although that the patient is moving, that there's no significant movement which is happening at the level of the acromioclavicular joint. There are a lot of pain generating structures within the shoulder. Hence, shoulder is one of the very few joints in musculoskeletal system which requires a standard protocol-based approach. Hence, it's a good idea to do a systematic examination, scanning the shoulder from the anterior aspect, looking at the biceps, the subscapularis, the acromioclavicular joint, from the lateral aspect, looking at the supraspinatus and the infraspinatus tendon, the subacromial subdeltoid bursa, and from the posterior aspect to assess the muscle bellies of the supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and the teres minor. And of course, do not forget to have a look at the glenohumeral joint as well. Before you go ahead with the shoulder examination, it's always a great idea to have a look at the radiographs and maybe a little bit of clinical examination. For whatever you know a little bit, it'll help you in a big, big way.